Yo, what's up? So, I have no plans as I sit down to record this piece. I was just motivated to actually sit in front of the mic this time because I just read this fantastic article on a site called Hacker Noon, wherein they talked about the show Rick and Morty and how you can actually learn a lot about the meaning of life. Basically, the entire article drives home the point that the show Rick and Morty is a very powerful allegory for spiritual enlightenment. Alright? Now, for those of you who do not know what I'm talking about, I would highly, highly recommend that you get onto Netflix and you just search for Rick and Morty. Don't be fooled. Yes, it is a cartoon. Yes, it is an Adult Swim product. It's a sister network or a sister channel of Cartoon Network. But man, that show is insane. I haven't come across anything, any work of art that is so deep on so many levels since I read Douglas Hofstadter with his book Gödel, Escher and Bach. I mean, the show has a driving consciousness of its own, and I will just stop myself here before I rant about the show's greatness. I would urge you to actually just watch the show, have a look at all the three seasons. I think they have the fourth season also coming up very soon, or is it out already? I'm not sure. So yeah, I mean, back to the article in Hacker Noon. There was this quote that the writer had alluded to from the Bhagavad Gita. Of all the books, man, the Bhagavad Gita and spiritual enlightenment really fucks with your head, okay? So there is this one parable quoted by Krishna to Arjuna, wherein when Arjuna is at his lowest on the battlefield in Kurukshetra, Krishna tells him, "I am come as time, the ultimate waster of people, ready for the hour that ripens to their doom. The warriors arrayed in hostile armies facing each other shall not live, whether you strike or stay your hand." It's a pretty fucked up passage. It really is. And the author mentions it in the article as well. Basically, in this parable, Krishna is not Krishna. He embodies his divine avatar as God or Father Time. And he's telling Arjuna that, you know, just get up and kill them, okay? Because they're already dead in the future, right? I mean, they're already going to die. If you come to think of it, that's really strange and on many levels. And this is what is so fascinating about the Mahabharata, right? It doesn't seem to have any core motive as far as its morality is concerned. Anything goes. You can have Yudhishthir, who is also called Dharmaraja because he is supposed to be the upholder of dharma, of duty and all its codices. He violates dharma at least two or three times through the entire epic. Whereas on the other hand, you have a Karna who probably only committed one grave sin of lying at the most inopportune times, and man, he just gets wrecked through the entire epic, right? I mean, there's nothing good that comes out of Karna's life apart from Karna's good deeds themselves. Yet you find the Pandavas not finding ascension to Swargaloka, which is the so-called, I mean, it's analogous to heaven, the concept of heaven, whereas the Kauravas make it a-okay. They're like, fine, we went there. I mean, this particular passage tells me exactly what is wrong with a lot of things in the Bhagavad Gita. Wrong in the sense, I won't say, I'm not pedantic or dogmatic, I'm just merely questioning this because I absolutely adore that book and I respect that book beyond any measure. I mean, I've been revisiting that book for forever now. It's been like 10 years and I still can't wrap my head around a lot of the concepts in that particular book. Just 18 chapters, God knows how many verses, and it just messes with your head each time. But you gotta think about this. When Arjuna is faced with a civil war and he can't seem to bring himself to actually cleanse his own blood, that's when Krishna actually steps in and he tells him, "Boss, listen, you were meant to do this. You are supposed to do this, right?" Now, there are many ways of looking at this. There are many ways of analyzing the Bhagavad Gita. one major proponent that comes out of it is that, listen, you are anyway not you during your course of life, right? You are that supreme self anyway. You're all connected anyway. You're a manifestation of that supreme divinity, and you're just one pair of eyes looking on at the universe. Basically, you're just this one mega fucking solipsistic venture of God, so to speak. God of the universe, right? That's one way of looking at it. But the other way to look at it is from a very psychotherapeutic point of view. This one instance where Arjuna has to face the demons of his own blood, so to speak. It's a very powerful allegory in the sense that to win this war that you're constantly waging in life, you often have to fight your own demons. You often have to wage a war against your own kin so as to come out on top. And you always have to have a vision for your ambition and never compromise on it. That's one way of looking at it. But I'll tell you what, man, this passage, I come as time, just kill them because they're going to be dead in the future. It really messes with my head. But the show Rick and Morty also operates on so many deep levels. I would really suggest that you have a watch and decide for yourself. I'll just put the quote in the description below, and maybe a small write-up or a link to the article that I'm talking about in the description. You can check it out for yourselves. So that's about it, guys. I mean, until next time, see ya.